Hello all, I'm Professor Sandeep Tigade, working as an assistant professor in A.G. Patel Institute of Technology, Solapur. So today we are going to focus on mechatronics. So introduction to mechatronics and its application, measurement characteristics, static and dynamic sensors, and position sensor, that is potentiometer, LVDT, incremental encoder, proximity sensor, optical inductive capacitive, and this is the syllabus for the first unit. First thing, what is mechatronics? Mechatronics is the synergistic combination of mechanical engineering, mecha for mechanism, electronics engineering for tronics for electronics, and software engineering. So basically mechatronics is the combination of mechanical part and as well as electronics part. Suppose if you take an example of a robot, so when to design a robot, basically based on the application, so its mechanism, its gears and all these things, structure designed by the mechanical engineer, and similarly whatever the electronic system is designed by the electronics engineer, which is based on application, and similarly what kind of software, what kind of programming language need to be selected, that is decided by the software engineer. So the word mechatronics was first coined by Mr. Tetsuro Moriya, a senior engineer of a Japanese company Yaskawa, in 1969. So mechatronics system, similarly control system, over here we can see on the screen, that is control system. This category is comprises of digital control system, similarly control electronics, and here for the computer, digital control system as well as mechanical CAD, these two combines a computer, and similarly mechanical system, mechanical CAD and electromechanics. So electronic system, here control electronics as well as electromechanical. So it is based on the application or area where we have selected. So in control system part, so automotive, aerospace, medical, likewise the area has been distinguished, and accordingly which kind of design system we have implement, that has been categorized over here based on the application. Okay, next one, the elements of mechatronics. In this one, mechanical system over here, the very first part, in a basic mechanical, recall that mechatronics block diagram, if you see the basic block diagram have only a sensor block diagram, okay, a sensor block, and similarly for the computation, for the manipulation, there is a logic circuit, or you can say microcontroller, and finally output side there is an actuator. This very simple basic block diagram is what? Sensor, microcontroller and actuator. So this is the simple basic block diagram, but the thing is what? Sensor, the n number of sensors we'll see, but the output of sensor, okay, with sensor we senses the physical parameter, that is temperature, weather, okay, humidity, etc. So that produces the certain output voltage, which is in terms of millivolt and microvolt, and very very small, which cannot drive even a diode or even a small components also, because it's very very small. That's why that sensor's output need to be amplified. So one more block is added over here, that is a signal conditioner, we can say amplifier. So coming to the point, sensors, if you see, so switches, potentiometer, photoelectric, digital encoder, strain gauge, thermocouple, accelerometer, etc, etc, so many sensors are there. Okay, so that sensor's output is very small, and it is fed or given input to the input signal conditioner. Signal conditioning means what? That signal, which is very very weak, has to be conditioned, has to be amplified with the help of an amplifier. So there are types of amplifier, you know, BJT amplifier, that is class A, class B, class C, etc. So based on application you can select, or else op-amp amplifier, so inverting, non-inverting. Okay, if you select an op-amp amplifier, inverting as well as non-inverting, for inverting minus RF upon R1, and it is a gain of a non-inverting amplifier. And similarly for non-inverting amplifier, that is 1 plus RF upon R1. Okay, so you can select one resistor and you can calculate another value. Okay, so if we take an example that the output of sensor is 10 millivolt, and the required output voltage of the signal conditioner is 5 volt, because further block is of microcontroller. So basic microprocessor, microcontroller needs minimum TTL voltage, that is 5 volt. So 5 volt. 5 volt is the output of the signal conditioner, and input is 10 millivolt. If we get the gain, okay, output upon input, that is we get around the 500. So gain of an amplifier is 500. So we can decide, we can select the value of register, and based on that we can design an amplifier. If it is not suitable, then we can further move to the two stage, that is instrumentation amplifier, two stage op amp, three stage op amp. Likewise, we can go for an amplifier. So in signal conditioner, so discrete components also can be there, and amplifier, that is analog to digital, etc., and all these things can be there. Similarly, in digital control architecture, okay, maybe there is a logic circuit and microcontroller, SBC, PLC, etc. for the computation or for the manipulation, for the processing purpose, for the controlling purpose. Okay, so the output of this microcontroller we cannot give directly to the actuator. So in between that, one more block is there, output signal conditioner. Okay, so that this block is also called as driver, we can say. Okay, because the output of this microcontroller is very very small. For example, 5 volt, and at 5 volt that too again DC, and that 5 volt, okay, we cannot interface or we cannot give to the DC motor, stepper motor, servo motor, solenoids, and all these things. Hydraulic pneumatic, highly impossible. So it is need to be again amplified at the output side. So here again we can also call it as a driver. Okay, so here it may be D2A converter, okay, amplifier, PWM, etc., and based on the applications. Okay, power transistor may be used, component power op amps are used. Okay, so here a particular, at particular level, current or voltage is amplified and it is fed or given to the actuators. Okay, and if you want any kind of a display, okay, so output of this conditioning, okay, is given to the display, so as it can display its value, its voltage or status. Okay, graphical display. So LEDs, LCD, digital display, CRT, etc., can be used for the visualization, that is for the display. And similarly, actuators, which is actual load is there. Okay, solenoid, voice coil, and the DC motor, stepper motor, servo motor, hydraulic, pneumatics, etc. So this is what the actuators. Okay, and this is what the short introduction to the elements of mechatronics. And we'll see what are the advantages. Why mechatronics and advantages and limitations of mechanical system. So there are so many advantages that mechanical system is a robust, make work easy and faster. Similarly, less energy is required and less exerted force is required over here. And similarly, for the limitation, if we see, so size matters a lot. So size limitation is there, weight limitation is there, and economic, that is cost, should not be that much high, because there is also kind of a limitation of the economics. Okay, economic, it should be highly economical, and okay, cost also one kind of limitation. If size and weight increases, definitely the required energy or power is increases, so that's also a limitation. And similarly, advantages of electronic system we see. So electronic system, no doubt, it operates on low voltage, low current, highly flexible, delicate, okay, and highly compatible, easily upgradable. So so many advantages of electronic systems are there, and limitation is also there. We cannot reduce the size of electronic system. Okay, it is up to the level. And similarly, it cannot drive. Okay, it cannot drive high voltage, high current devices. That's what has a limitation to the electronic system. And similarly, now role of the computer is very important here. What kind of programming language you are going to select, what kind of operating system we are using, is based on applications. So role of computer is very very important over here. Okay, similarly, now to select sensors, kind of a sensor. So there are measurement of characteristics, what kind of sensor we should select. So it's having the range, resolution, accuracy. We will see one by one here. Range, okay, so what will be the minimum and maximum range of that sensor? It is decided by the manufacturer. So difference between the maximum and minimum value of the sensor parameter of that sensor particularly. Resolution, the smallest change the sensor can differentiate. Suppose if we take an example of an ocean, okay, once we take out the bucket full of water from the ocean, is there any change that we can find in the ocean? Obviously, from the we cannot see the change, but exactly what happens is some water has been extracted from the ocean. This is what the change that we have observed. The same like the sensor, whatever the smallest changes are there, that can be sensed by our sensor. Similarly, accuracy, difference between the measured value and the true value that you know. okay, whatever the value that we get from the sensor, that should be very, very near to the okay, accurate value or the values which is given by the manufacturer. Precision, ability to reproduce whatever the value is given by the manufacturer, okay, our sensor should reproduce that value again and again, which is very, very close, or you can say exact value or near to the that value. Similarly, now sensitivity, ratio of change in output to a unit change of the input, that sensor should be highly, highly sensitive. Okay, similarly, zero offset, the sensor which is having zero input should give zero output. That's why a non-zero value for a no input. Next one is linearity. Okay, percentage of deviation from the best fit linear calibration curve. So here, whatever the linear, whatever the readings are there, okay, on the curve, whatever the points are there, okay, our value should be very, very close to that one. Okay, that's why the closeness of the calibration curve to a specified straight line, that is theoretical behavior or least square fit. Similarly, next point, that is a zero drift. Zero drift, the departure of the output from zero value over a period of time for no input. Similarly, if there is a no input, the departure output should be from the zero. Okay. Response time, obviously the response time of the sensor should be very, very small. Ideally should be zero, but response time should be very, very less. Means when the sensor senses the physical parameter, immediately should respond. That's why the time lag between the input and output. Similarly, the operating temperature, the range in which the sensor performs as specified. Okay, so for each and every electronic component, or you can say sensor, they mention, the manufacturer mentions its operating temperature from minus 55 to 100 degree centigrade, plus 100 degree centigrade or 200 degree centigrade. In between that, that sensor should work smoothly, favorably. Okay, dead band, the range of input for which there is no output. So such kind of dead band word that we have used in hysteresis curve, magnetization curve. Okay, in that dead band, our system remains ideal. It is in off state, means it is not working over there. Okay, dead band. Now, range and resolution. Already we had a discussion. Okay, the range of a sensor is the difference between the minimum and maximum input that will give a valid output. Okay, we have taken one example. Okay, similarly, a range is typically specified by the manufacturer. Already we know. Okay, if we take an example of K-type thermocouple, has a range of 800 degree centigrade. Here, minus 50 degree centigrade to 750, that sensor works very smoothly. Resolution part. The resolution of a sensor is the smallest increment of input that can be reliably detected. CMM. Already we had a description. Resolution is also frequently known as the least count of the sensors. Smallest to smallest change that should be counted, that should be taken into account. Okay, that is nothing but the resolution. It should be highly resolved. The resolution of analog sensor is usually limited only by low level electrical noise and is often much better than equivalent digital sensors. Okay, so this is what about the range and resolution. So next part we'll discuss in the next lecture. Thank you very much.